Happy Sunday, and thank you for joining us. You may be home, in your kitchen, in your bedroom, or maybe you're driving home from work. But if you are, keep your eyes on the road. Today we're going to get into the book of Ephesians, chapter 1. We're going to look at this phrase that people abuse. God bless you. That's the title of my message today. We will explore various ways Paul say, God bless you in Christ. And we'll speak about the redemption through his blood. As Paul began in this letter, he did not highlight his situation. He was under house arrest. But he opens up with Jesus. He spoke about Jesus first. He went through three chapters before he spoke about his situation. In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 1. For this cause, I, Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles. Paul did not gripe about his situation, about what he was in. But what he did, he put Jesus first. This is a great example we could follow. When we're going through our trials and our tribulations, don't wear it on our sleeves. Make every attempt to magnify Jesus. As we continue, we're going to look at a few things that happened here. Paul did not complain. Paul did not gripe. But Paul put Jesus in the center. There's a song that I want to take. I want to take a few words from it. This was written by Reverend Paul Jones. He wrote, I Won't Complain. He said, I've had some good days. I had some hills to climb. I had some weary days. I had some sleepless nights. But when I look around and think things over, all of my good days outweigh my bad days. I won't complain. That's the point that we got to look at. There's times when situation comes, we might feel burdened down. We might feel overwhelmed. But let's look at Ephesians chapter 1 and see how Paul speak about God blessing us in Christ. In Ephesians chapter 1, Paul, the apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, and the saints which are at Ephesus, to the faithful in Christ Jesus, grace be unto you, and peace from God our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul was very wise in the way that he brings the word and the way that he written his epistle to every church. In this epistle here in Ephesians, Paul is talking to two groups of people. Let's look at these groups of people that Paul was speaking of. If you notice, he said, the saints which are at Ephesus. And then he says, to the faithful in Christ Jesus. That sounds like he's actually repeating himself, but if you take a closer look of what he's saying, the two groups of people that he's speaking of is the faithful and the unfaithful. What category we're going to find ourselves in? If we search ourselves, we fall in one. As we continue in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, we're going to look at the blessings that Paul spoke about. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. These gifts are in heavenly places. How do we access them? We have to be in the Spirit to access these gifts. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4, chapter 2, verse 14 says, "But the natural man received not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them because they are spiritually discerned." You cannot access spiritual gifts in the flesh. You cannot war in the flesh because the enemy that we fight is spiritual. The enemy that we fight, he doesn't fight fear. And for us to win this fight, we have to fight him with what God's word says. As a matter of fact, the God that we serve is a spirit, and we can't worship him in the flesh. But it's because the Bible says, God seeketh true worshiper, and those that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So as we explore these gifts that Paul speaks about, the ones that he said they are in heavenly places, how do we access them? Let's see what they are. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4, he says here, "What I did, I highlighted each blessing that Paul, spoke about. And I'll highlight them as we go." Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4, "According as he had chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love." The first gift that we get in heavenly places that he said we were chosen before the foundation of the world. That's the first blessing that we got. We were chosen before. And how do we know that we were chosen before? If you look at Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 4 through 5. This is in my notes. So it says here, "Then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou comest forth out of the womb, I have sanctified thee. And I have ordained thee to be a prophet unto the nations." This is before Jeremiah was born. And we could take that to ourselves and say that before we were born, before our father and our mother came together, God called us. All right? So the first gift that we see here is that we were chosen before the foundation of the world. And the second gift is that we be holy and without blame before him. Now, holiness is not what we do, because the Bible says our righteousness are filthy rags. So we can't do nothing to be accepted in the beloved. We have to work according to what the Bible says is through his spirit. And this holiness, he says holiness and blameless before him. And he says here, dedicated and to be consecrated, to the Most High God. So our consecration and our holiness is in God. So if we dig a little further and see what he's saying here, if you have done something wrong, God has wiped that slate clean. So you're standing before him blameless because of the blood of Christ. And he says, in his love, "The love of God has appeared to all men." And the love is what chases us. It's the love that was convict us. Because the Bible says that it's the love of God that bring man to repentance. As we continue here, in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 6, 5 through 6, "Having predestined us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glory, of his grace, wherein he had made us acceptable in the beloved." So we are acceptable in the beloved. So that's another gift that he has given us. We were predestined and we were adapted into the beloved. And let's look at what he's saying here. In Galatians chapter 4, verse 6, and he says, "Because you are sons, God has sent forth the spirit of his son in your heart, where you cry, Abba, Father." So now we are the children of God. And the Bible even says, it has not appeared what we shall be, but we shall be like him. All right? So That's one of the other gifts that was given. Now he said, accepted in the beloved. In Genesis, in Genesis chapter 4, verse 12, he says that, and when you till the ground, it shall not henceforth yield unto thee her strength, but a fugitive and a vagabond thou shalt be into the earth. What that is saying is that after Cain killed Abel, God have cast him out and said that you're going to be wandering through the earth. This is the curse because of you slaying a man or you slaying your own brother. But I want you to know that you are not a vagabond. I am not a vagabond. We are children of God. He has chosen us in himself. You are not a reject. I am not a reject. We are engrafted into the beloved. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7, it says, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. In verse 8, wherein he had abounded towards us in all wisdom and prudence. Let's look at what he's speaking of here. Redemption through his blood. Jesus has redeemed us through his blood. In 1 John chapter 7, 1 John chapter 7, chapter 1, verse 7, the blood of Jesus has, you know, ransomed us, had paid for us, and is the greatest gift to mankind. He says here, but if we walk in the flesh, if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all our sins. So that's the other gift that we got, the redemption in the blood of Jesus. Now the forgiveness of sins, that's another gift. In Luke chapter 24, verse 47, and he says, and that repentance and remissions of sin should be preached in his name, beginning at Jerusalem. So those are the gifts that was given to us. And it says the riches of his grace. Now, grace is God's unmerited favor. There's nothing that we have done to deserve it, but what God did is because of his love. All right? The love of God is what bring us in. As we continue in Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 9, he says, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he had purposed in him, that in the dispensation of the fullness of time, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven, which are in the earth, even in him. So if we look, the mystery of his will, the mystery of Jesus' will is wrapped up in Jesus. And how do we know that? Let's look at what the word says. The answer to every human being today, the answer to every situation that we are going through is in Jesus. Because we know that it's only what we do in Christ will last. Everything else is temporal. As we look today and we see what's going on with the virus is going crazy. People are getting, you know, infected and people, all the riches and everything that they have is not able to help them. But we have hope in Jesus. And we, as the church, we have to stand, we have to believe, and we have to encourage. Because we have the Spirit of God that leading us every day. All right? As we continue in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 11, and it says, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purchase, according to the I'm sorry. Being predestined according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ. So this is the other gift that we find in heavenly places. We have obtained an inheritance that we only get in Christ. For the Bible says, all things are yours, and all things are Christ, and Christ is God. As we continue in verse 13, he says, in whom ye also trust after he heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after ye believe, ye were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. So this is another gift. We heard the word. We heard the word of God. And we know that the word of God is truth. God has not left us in darkness. As a matter of fact, he said he have brought us out of darkness into his marvelous light. We are not without counsel. We are not without direction. God has not left us alone. His word is what is going to guide us in these evil times that we are living in. In Luke chapter 4, verse 3 to 4, and he says, and the devil said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, command these stones to be made bread. Jesus answered and said, it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. So the truth that we have, the truth that we heard, the truth that we must live, it is written. We got to take the example that Christ set for us. It is written. So anytime your situation come, just remember, it's in the word. So that's one gift that we got. We heard the word. The next one, we are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19, it says, nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his, and let everyone that name the name of the Lord, or the name of Christ, depart from iniquity. So when we have the word of truth, it will prevent us, or protect us, or shield us from doing wrong. So the word of God is what we stand for. And the Bible says, thy word have I hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. So if you have not heard the word, you're not able to act on the word. But if you hear it, then you activate faith to receive that word in your life. So these gifts are not, they are not physical gifts. They are spiritual gifts, because the Bible says we are seated together in heavenly places, as the scripture I read before. We are seated together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. As we continue in verse 14 and 15, he says, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. He says, wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and the love unto all the saints. Verse 16, I cease not to give thanks and to make mention of you in my prayers. Verse 17 says, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. So when you are sealed with the spirit of promise, there are gifts that you even access in the spirit. In verse 18 and 19, he says that the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that he may know what is the hope of your calling and what is the riches of his glory, for of the inheritance of the saints, and what is the exceedingly greatness of his power to usward who believe according to the working of his mighty power. So another gift is that the hope of your calling, And as a matter of fact, another verse says that it is a high calling. You know, if we, God has called us. He said he has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. In Acts chapter 16, verse 18 tells us to open your eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, and that they may receive forgiveness for sins and the inheritance among them that are sanctified by faith that is in me, that's in Christ. You are a great value to Christ. Philippians chapter 3, verse 14, he says, for I press towards the mark of the price of the high calling. So the hope of the calling is a high calling. And God has called us in Christ to come after him with our whole hearts. Ephesians chapter 20 and 21, he says, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. He says, far above all principalities and powers and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but in the world to come. So the access that we have in the Spirit, he says that it was wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand. These gifts that he's speaking of in heavenly places, they were hidden from the foundation of the world, but they are revealed to us, the church. Because we know in Ephesians, it says, there are principalities and powers, spiritual wickedness in high places. The way to access these gifts, we have to fight in the spirit. We got to fight in our minds. We got to fight through all the situations that are around us, especially that this time that we are living in, with the virus going rampant and running through families, and people are being, you know, affected and losing their lives, and families are hurt, and everybody are just confused. But my encouragement to you, remember what the Word of God said. Don't be so caught up in the news and the media and what you get over the internet. Because if you consume all of that in your mind, you're going to have sleepless nights. You're going to be tormented by that. But my encouragement to you is pull away from it. Turn to God, you know, get in his word and seek him. You probably lose your job. You know, you might be, you know, home. You can't go out. You are you're on your last dime. You can't buy food or anything. And you feel like, oh, I'm hopeless. I don't know what else to do. Listen, I'm telling you this from experience. I was out of a job for 2 years, and I was home. I felt down. I felt depressed, and my wife was telling me, you need to get up. You need to shake this off, and it took me a while to do it. I was home with the kids, and I had to get myself together, and I sent my resume out, and, you know, God has opened a door and made a way for me. It might not be the same situation that you're in, but we serve the same God that able to open the doors for you, all right? So you might be home right now and you're wondering, you know, I don't know what else to do. You know, I hear what the word says and I'm trusting God, but I see nothing is moving. Don't give up. Hold on. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 22 and 23, he says, had put all things under his feet and gave to him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, that the fullness of him that filleth all and in all. I want you to remember this. God has not forgotten you. You are a part of the church. You might be home sitting down in your living room, in your bedroom, in the kitchen. Just remember, God has not forgotten you. He's watching everything that you do. He's watching you respond to the situation that you're going through. Remember, the Bible said you're overcome by your testimony. People might be listening and waiting for you to say, you know what, and start complaining and start grumbling. But I want you to remember, God is watching your every move. Just remember, it's not reacting to what you're seeing or what you're feeling. But just remember, trust God. It's not easy. Trials come. Trials are there to make you strong. Remember, when you're going through your situation, don't keep this in mind. These trials are there to make you strong, and it's how you react to them. Remember, every process, how do you get a testimony? You got to go through a test. There's a scripture that says that for us to enter into the kingdom of God, we'll go through trials and tribulation. The apostles did. Why not us? In these times that we are living in, I could take this title from a book that that came to my mind. It says, the book is The Best Time and the Worst Time. This is the best time for the church. When you react, remember, put God in your reaction. Put God in everything that you do. Fall on your face, cry out to him, and watch him work the situation out. Paul did. The apostles did. Here he stands in Ephesians, and he giving you encouragement. How do you walk when you feel like you can't stand? The Bible says, when you have done all to stand, stand therefore. Stand in the liberty where Christ has made us free. Remember, the word is the lamp unto our feet and the light unto our path. I know what you're going through. I could identify with you because I've been there. I've been out of a job. I've been, you know, home. Don't know where the next money's coming from to pay the bills or buy food in the supermarket. But just remember, God brought me through. God has made a way for me, and he can make a way for you. Just remember that his love is unconditional. If you have messed up, turn to him. Turn to him right now and watch him work your life, turn the situation around. It doesn't matter what you're going through, because we all have to go through something. The Bible said creation waited for the manifestations of the sons of God. He said, it has not yet appeared what we shall be, but when we see him, we shall be like him. Jesus loves you. My encouragement to you today is hold on. Continue to pray. Continue to be faithful. Yes, you are home. Yes, you are watching me right now over the web. Just remember, God loves you, and he's going to come through for you. He has not failed. He will never fail. He cannot fail. David said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. You might feel like, oh my God, that scripture doesn't apply to me because I have no food in the closet. I have no money in the bank. I have no money in my wallet. Just remember, God owns a cattle on a thousand hills, and he will make a way for you. Will you trust him today? Will you hold on to him? Whose report will you believe? The Bible says, we will believe the report of the Lord. His report say he will provide. His report say he will make a way. We just got to trust him. Listen, every situation that you're going through, God said he will use it for his glory. Because we know that all things work together for good. For them that love God, for those that are called according to his purpose. So my encouragement to you today and my prayer for you today is that hold on to Jesus. Watch him work your situation. Watch him turn it around. He did it for me, and he did it for a lot of people that's watching right now. And if they testify and they'll tell you what they've been through, it will help you. So my encouragement to you, I'm going to pray for you right now, and I'm believing that God is going to work for you. He's going to turn the situation around because he said that you are the child of God. And the Bible says we are seated together in heavenly places in Christ. And then let's get into the heavenly places now. Father, in the name of Jesus, let's pray. Put the forks down. Stop eating the breakfast. Put the food down. Let's pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before your presence right now. We thank you for your faithfulness, God. We pray, oh God, to move in every homes, move on every man, every woman, every child. Father God, they might be out of a job. They might not have food. They might be affected by this virus. But Lord, we stand on your word and we claim healing right now in the name of Jesus. We pray, God, for deliverance. We pray, God, for your provision, God. Let it go in the house. Let it provide. Let it make a way. Father, I pray, God, for every person, oh God, that's watching and hearing, Lord. I pray, God, that you make a way. Make a way, Father God. You have done it before. You have not failed. even in this pandemic, oh God, Lord, you have not fallen off the throne. Lord, you're still ruling and reigning. You are Lord of all. So right now, I bring every child of God before you, Lord. I pray, God, that you make a way. I pray that you meet them in their need, oh God. I pray, God, that you make a way, supply all the needs that's in Christ. And Father, we thank you that all these gifts that you've given is in heavenly places. And Father, we access them right now by your Spirit, Lord. We pray, oh God, that you give us strength, oh God, in our situation. You said, having all to stand, stand therefore. Oh God, we stand on your word and we claim your promises, oh God, that Lord, you will make a way. We have nobody else to trust. We have nobody else to turn to, because some put their trust in chariots, some put their trust in man, but we will put our trust in the name of the Lord. Father, we thank you. We thank you for providing now. We thank you for blessing now. We thank you for opening the door now. We thank you for the situation, God, that is going to cause our faith to grow in you. Father, I thank you right now. Don't let my brother, don't let my sister fail. Oh God, strengthen their faith, oh God. Strengthen their faith. We thank you, Lord, for doing it right now. Father, let your will be done, oh God, in their homes, in their lives. Father God, turn it around for them, oh God. Turn the situation around. Lord God, whatever you have to do, God, you said you will do it if we just believe and we agree with your word this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Bless you. I praise God for you and I thank God for you. Just continue to be, hope and trust in him. In Jesus' name.